Okay, so our next topic is the origin of cultivated plants and where your centers of origin. Okay, now as you know, we are talking about the chapter number 4, that is the plant resource development. Now under this plant resource development, we have to study the various kinds of plants which are very beneficial from the human point of view. Okay, and not only that, we have to also deal with the whatever the origin of the cultivated plants are there, or whatever the plants material we are consuming today, how they got originated, and what are the centers of their origin. That too we have to study. Okay, so in this particular video lecture, we have to understand what is the origin of the cultivated plants, that is whatever the cultivated plants today we use in our agriculture, where they got originated. Okay, and what are the Vavilio centers of origin. Okay, these are two topics are comparatively relatable with each other, because origin of the cultivated plants is actually given by the Vavilio. Okay, now Vavilio's centers of origin actually gives you the idea about the origin of the cultivated plants. Hence these two topics are comparable or related with each other, and that is why we should consider them together. Okay, so consider, this is your syllabus. We are dealing with the paper 1 and the chapter number 4, that is the plant resource development, under which we are studying the origin of the cultivated plants and Vavilio's centers of origin. Okay, now see the introductory point. See, human beings are the heterotrophs. As you know, when we divide the living organism, we divide the living organism into the two types, right? Autotrophs, and then we say there are the heterotrophs, right? Autotrophs are those organisms which can prepare their own food. Okay, these are the plants. Okay, plants can prepare their own food, and certain kinds of the bacteria were also autotrophs. Okay, but on the other hand, we are humans, or the animals are the heterotrophs, because they cannot prepare their own food. Okay, humans or rest of the animals, they cannot prepare their own food, and they were dependent for the food on the other organism, right? Just for example, we are dependent on the autotrophs, or we are dependent on the other animals for our food needs. And that is why we say the human beings are heterotrophs. Okay, that is, they cannot prepare their own food, but they are dependent for their food material on the other living beings. Okay, so that is why we are saying the humans are heterotrophs. Now they derive their nutrition from the plants and the animals. Okay, other plants and the animals, we regularly exploit them for our food material need. Okay, now but man has evolved from the herbivorous ancestors. Okay, now here the one thing you have to understand is that we have the herbivorous ancestors. That literally means the our ancestors were like to consume the plant material only, but somewhere in the evolution we have turned to animal based food as well. Okay, that is, animal based food as well as plant based food we start to consume somewhere 2 billion years ago. Okay, so earlier our ancestors were only the herbivores. Okay, that is, they were taking out the tubers from the ground, and we are living on these tubers, and hence typically we were the herbivores. That is, we are eating only the plant based food material. But later we have started using the animal food as well, and for that we have started to create the weapons for the hunting. Okay, so once we have invented the weapons for the hunting, we starts to hunt the animals, and these animals were regularly consumed by the humans then. So basically humans are not only consuming the plants, they were also consuming the animals. Okay, but first of all, in the evolution we were herbivores, and we were first starting our food diet from the plant. So it becomes very, very important from where this plant material is coming, on which the earlier human beings were dependent. That is, where these crop plants were there, or which crop plants were there earlier, on which these human beings are surviving. Okay, because right from here we have started the hint for the agriculture, right? Because we have selected some of the plants from the wild, and we started to use them as our food material, right? So you can say that from here the origin of cultivated plants can start it. Okay, and see, the origin, the center of origin, is the geographical area where the particular group of organism, either domesticated or wild, first originated on the earth. Okay, literally here you have to understand the center of origin term. Okay, what do you mean by the center of origin? Now center of origin is such a place where a particular group of organism, either they were domesticated or they may be in the wild form, okay, first got originated. For example, consider this Indian hotspot. Now here there are many varieties of the rice. Okay, now rice, all of the sudden you will find the many varieties in this Indian subcontinent, and you can trace the center of origin of the rice by using their genetic material. Okay, once we study the genetic material of such a rice, we can actually trace where this particular rice is got originated, because maximum of the rice varieties were concentrated in this particular Indian subcontinent. So center of origin is that geographical area where the group of organism, either they may be the domesticated or the wild, first got originated on the earth. Okay, whenever on the earth the first organism is got originated in such a place, the such a place is called as the center of origin. Okay, for example, if some of the horses were present in the America and these were horses were first originated in the America, then we say for these horse the center of origin is the America, and for the rice the center of origin in the is the India, because first time that organism or that plant or that animal first time got originated in that particular geographical area. Hence that geographical area denotes the center of origin for that particular animal or the plants. Okay, now see, many people believe that the center of origin also is the center of diversity. See, this is the very basic for the Wavelio center of origin. Many scientists think that whatever the center of origin is there, for example, the rice is the center of center of origin is located in the India. So maximum of the diversity of the rice will found in that particular center of origin. That literally means if something is found, for example, here there is a one plant species which got originated, so you will find the maximum diversity of these particular species in this particular area. Okay, that is the center of origin and the center of diversity is same. Where you find the center of origin for a particular species, you will definitely find the center of diversity for this organism, because maximum number of wild relatives will present in that surrounding as well. Okay, for example, in the India we have discovered there is a rice. Okay, so maximum varieties of the rice will be situated in the India. So India is not only the center of origin for the rice but also the center of diversity for the rice. Okay, this point gives you the clue where the center of origin actually locates. You can find the center of origin by just looking at the varieties. How many varieties of that particular plants are found in that surrounding? If you find the maximum varieties in that particular area, you can say that plant has the center of origin there. Okay, and if you find somewhere else that plant but you do not find the much of the diversity, then that plant must have been introduced. Okay, it must be introduced from the center of origin there. So it cannot be the center of origin for that plant. But where you will find the maximum diversity in that particular geographical area where the plant is got originated, certainly you can say that the plant got originated there and it also the center of diversity for that particular plant. Right, now see, but the centers of diversity may not represent the center of origin for the crop plants. Now this becomes difficult. Okay, on the one hand we say where the center of origin is there, maybe there will be the center of diversity, but this is not entirely true for the crop plants, because as you know, the crop plants were regularly introduced from the one country to the other country, or you can say the crop plants are introduced from the one geographical area to the other geographical area. So it will be difficult to trace where this particular center of origin for these particular plants. Okay, because these crop plants were regularly introduced in the other geographical areas, so the center of diversity may not represent the center of origin for the crop plants. See, a few species may have been originated separately at more than one places. Okay, this is also the case that some variety of the rice which is evolved in the India, maybe somewhere else such a kind of rice may have evolved separately. That is the two centers of the origin for the plant may be possible. Okay, it's a possibility that the two plants may have the one plant may have the two centers of origin. Okay, they may have originated separately at more than one place. Okay, but most of the species had their origin at a certain place then spread elsewhere. Okay, but for the majority of the species, if we give out the exception, okay, for the majority of the species the center of origin is only the single center, and then these plants were introduced in the rest of the world. Okay, this is the general scenario, but exceptionally the plant may have the two centers of origin. Okay, and the centers of origin may not have the center of diversity. But when you talk about the in general criteria, we say the center of origin may correspond to the center of diversity as well, and there is a one center of origin for one species and it may got diversified throughout the world then the rest of the time period. Okay, see, so the center of origin and the center of diversity is quite relatable, but certain times there are exceptions. Okay, now consider, in other words, in the center of origin the crop plants is generally confined to the one place, whereas the center of diversity may be found more than one places. Okay, see what is happening then. See, center of origin may be the one place. Okay, see, for example, here is the center of origin for that particular plant, but center of diversity may be the more than one. Okay, that is, you will find the diversity of that plant in more than one place. Okay, so center of origin is actually the one origin. This is the confirmed thing. Okay, that is the center of origin will remain only the one center, because there this particular plant is got originated, but later it got diversified. Okay, and its diversity found in the rest of the rest of the geographical areas. And this geographical area is not restricted to the one only. It may be the two, maybe the two, maybe three, maybe four. Okay, many geographical areas are there in which the particular species is showing the varieties, many varieties. That is, the diversity is shown by such a species at many places. But what is happening in majority of the time, that these centers are the more than one centers of the diversity is shown by the species, but the center of origin is only the one center. Okay, on the earth there is only the one center of origin for that particular plant species. Maybe there will be the many centers of diversity, okay, but the center of origin is only one. See, the information on the origin of the crop plants is important in the plant breeding to locate the wild relatives, then the related species and the new genes. See why this information becomes important regarding the diversity of the genomes. Okay, that is the species diversity. If you find the species diversity, or if you have the information on the origin of the crop plants, it becomes very, very important in the plant breeding program. Now, what is the importance of the information relating with the origin of the crop with that of the plant breeding program? See, what we do in the plant breeding program? In the plant breeding, we take the wild relative of an organism. For example, we have the domesticated A species, and we have taken the wild relative Z, because this Z wild relative has some special characteristics, and we want these special characteristics in the A species which we have domesticated. So we have crossed these species and we have created the new species which is called as X. Okay, and the whatever the desirable characters which are present in the Z were also present in the A now, okay, in the form of X. So in this way, in the plant breeding, we can create the new superior varieties. Okay, but for creating these superior varieties, we should find the wild relatives first. Okay, we should know where the wild relatives are. So to find the wild relatives, we should know the origin, the center of origin of the plant. And once we know the center of origin of the plant, you will get the wild relatives there. Okay, whatever the A plant is there, the wild relatives of the A plant you will find in that origin. Okay, once you know the origin, maximum wild relatives of that species will be there. Okay, and that is why the information relating with the origin of the crop plants, it becomes very important in the plant breeding program. Okay, to locate the wild relatives first of all, and then the related species, whatever the related species are there, you will find the related species in that particular center of origin, plus the new genes which are present in these related species can also be exploited in the plant breeding program. So to assess the wild relatives, to have the related species, or to exploit the new genes, we should know the information relating the origin of crop plants. That is where this particular crop plant is got originated. Once you know it, then you can go at that place and you will find the wild relatives of that species there. And in this way, you will also find the new genes for the plant breeding program. Right, so the information on the origin of crop plant becomes very, very important in the plant breeding program. Right, see, the knowledge of the origin of the crop plant is also important to avoid the genetic erosion, loss of germplasm due to the loss of ecotypes and the habitat. See, as you know, in the today's world, the habitat loss is the major problem, because this particular habitat loss is responsible for giving out the germplasm from the earth. Okay, now what is meant by the germplasm? Whatever the genome possessed by the particular species, this particular genome is referred to as a germplasm. Okay, now for example, say in the India, we have domesticated the rice. Okay, and all the relatives of the rice were present in the India. Now what is happening when there is a loss of habitat from the India, these rice along with these wild relatives may got lost from the mother earth. Now we will lose the genetic material from the mother earth. If the rice is gone from the India due to the habitat destruction or the ecotype destruction, then in such a case, these particular whole genome, which is very useful for the humankind, may got disappear from the mother earth. So in such a case, if you have the knowledge regarding the origin of crop plants, we can actually conserve that particular particular geographical area, because that particular geographical area is giving us the rice, and that is why that particular geographical area along with its wild relatives, we should conserve it. Okay, so the origin of the crop plants will also give us the opportunity to save our wild ancestors of our crop plants. Whatever the crop plants we are using today, these crop plants have the wild relatives, and these wild relatives should be carefully conserved. Okay, and the knowledge regarding the origin of crop plants will allow us to do that. All right, now consider, See, the Russian scientist, whose name is Nikolai Ivanovich Vavilios, and his colleagues has visited the several countries and collected the large number of crop plants and their wild relatives. Now see, why Vavilios' name is always there whenever we talk about the origin of the crop plants or origin of the plants, okay? Now see here, the Vavilios, what he has done is that he visited the many countries, okay, several countries he has visited, and he has found out the centers of origin for the crop plants, okay. Whatever the plants we are using today as a crop material, these centers of origin of these crop plants were actually found out by the Vavilio, okay. He and his team has visited many countries throughout the world, and they have found out that there are the various centers of the origin for the crop plants, okay, because they have scientifically studied that particular geographical area, and in that particular geographical area, they have found out the wild maximum wild relatives of such a plant species, okay, where this particular plant species is got originated. Then they have found out there are the many wild relatives which are present in that particular geographical area, and hence this particular geographical area is the origin of that particular crop plant. And who has done this scientific work? This scientific work is done by the Vavilio. Okay, he has visited the many countries, and he have find out the origin of the geographical area where the origin of the cultivated plants can be traced. Okay, so he was the very, very important scientist regarding the origin of the cultivated plant. Now they have used this collection in the Russian breeding program for developing the improved varieties. Now of course he is the Russian scientist, and there is a Russian breeding program, and for this breeding program they have requirement of the knowledge regarding the origin of the crop plants. Okay, and for that this team has got formulated, and the head of this team was the Vavilio, and he rightfully find out that where are the centers of origin for the cropland, and then they have scientifically used this information in the Russian breeding program to create the improved varieties. Okay, as you know, in the green revolution we have used the improved varieties which are created through the plant breeding program, and these improved varieties have created the revolution through the agriculture. Okay, and that is why we are self-sufficient now in the food material. So the plant breeding programs are very, very important program for the any country, and Russia is not the exception. In the Russian breeding program, the Vavilio's contribution was so large that the origin of centers were actually given in his name, okay, that is, which are called as the Vavilio centers of origin. So Vavilio has given the centers of origin for the various cultivated crop plants, and then this information they have used in the Russian breeding program for developing the high yield varieties. Okay, now see, his deductions were based on the evidence from the morphology, then anatomy, cytology, genetics, plant geography, and the distribution. Okay, for his studies to locate the origin of the crop plants, which criteria he has used the morphological criteria, then the anatomical, then the cytological studies, genetic studies, plant geography, and the distribution. Okay, all these variables he has used to trace the origin of the crop plants. Now see, he considered that the great centers of origin were always located on the lower mountains and the hills of the tropical and the subtropical region. Now see, this is very, very important point. Now from his research, what he has concluded, that whatever the great centers of origin are there, okay, whatever the centers of origin are there, which are found out by the Vavilios, he said that they were located in the lower mountains, okay, in the lower mountainous region, the centers of origin were located, and in the hills of the tropical and the subtropical region, okay, whatever the hills are there in the tropical and the subtropical region, these are the main regions where the our today's crop plants got originated. So whatever the centers of origin he has found out, there is a common point within these centers of origin. What is that common point? That majority of the time these centers of origin were located in the lower mountains or on the hills of the tropical or the subtropical region. From this point you can say that the tropical and the subtropical area is actually the area in which the maximum of our crop plant species got domesticated in this particular area. Okay, here this is the equator, and above the equator and below the equator we have the tropical and the subtropical area. In this tropical and the subtropical area you will find on the hills and in the lower of the mountains you will find the great centers of origins are located there, and these are great centers of the origin were also called as the primary centers of origin, because these are primary centers of origin are those places where these particular plants can actually be seen in a much of the diversity. Okay, so the primary centers of origin were located maximally in the lower mountains or the in on the hills of the tropical and the subtropical region. Then he also recognizes some of the secondary centers of origin where two or more species cross together. Now, Vavilov not only given the primary centers of origin, he has also given the secondary centers of origin as well. Okay, where in the secondary center you will find the less diversity when it compares with the primary center, but some of the species got crossed with each other here, and that is why some amount of the diversity were also found in the secondary centers of origin. Okay, so in the primary center of origin you will find the maximum of the diversity in the plants, and where there is the exact origin of the crop plant is there. And then there is a secondary center of origin where the less diversity is there, but still some of the main plants get crossed there, and that is why some amount of the diversity will also found there. And these are places were rightfully denoted as a secondary centers of origin. Okay, where the two or more species may have crossed together. Now see, secondary centers of origin are a places where the natural or the artificial selection has occurred after the one another. Okay, that is the natural selection through the natural forces, or the artificial selection through the human point of view has been occurred, and human has cultivated this particular plant species. Hence the diversity, the very strong diversity is found at that cultivated area as well. So such area can be considered as a secondary center of origin. Okay, so the natural center of origin or the artificial center of origin can be the different things. Okay, actually the primary centers of origin are the main centers of origin, and from this place humans may have taken out the plant and starts the breeding program somewhere else. So at that place where the breeding program has started, you will find some of the diversity. This can be considered as a secondary center. Okay, but the primary natural center is the different center where actually this particular plant species is got originated. Okay, so the secondary centers of origin and the primary centers of origin are different from one another. The primary centers of origin are those areas where the first that plant is got originated, but in the secondary centers of origin you will find someone has taken that plant there, and the plant breeding naturally or the artificially may have occurred, and that is why you will find some of the diversity there. So this can be considered as a secondary center of origin. Now see, he has stated that the plants were not domesticated at a random, but it was the continuous process. Okay, what he has also concluded, the plants were not domesticated randomly, but it is a continuous process. Okay, there is no randomness in the domestication process, but the continuous process is there through which the humans have domesticated these particular plants. Okay, so this is how the Vavilov has visited the different countries, and he has located the primary centers of origin and then the secondary centers of origin, and he has given this type of the conclusion from his research. Now see, let us consider the Vavilov centers of origin. Okay, so which centers is actually given by the Vavilov? Okay, see, he published his result in the 1926, and he has developed the theory on the centers of origin of the cultivated plants, and he actually proposed the 8 centers of origin for the crop plants. Okay, so in 1926 he has completed his research, and he has developed the theory regarding the centers of origin of the crop plants, where the crop plants is got originated throughout the world. Relating with this, the Vavilov has created the theory in 1926, and actually he has given the 8 major centers where this particular plant species is got originated. Whatever the crop plants we are using today, they were the total 8 centers throughout the world. These 8 centers are there in which the our crop plants is got originated. Okay, now consider the very first center, which is called as the Chinese center of origin. Okay, of course this is located in the China region. Okay, so in the Chinese center, it is considered to be the one of the earliest and the largest independent center of the origin of cultivated plants. See, we have to remember, because all of the 8 centers you should be able to distinguish, okay, area wise, the scale wise, okay, geographical area wise, the from the plant species wise. Okay, so that is why it becomes very important point that it is the earliest center of origin of the crop plant, and it is the largest independent center of the origin of cultivated plant. Okay, it's the largest one among the 8. The largest center of origin is located in the China, which is called as the Chinese center of origin for the cultivated plants. Now this center includes the mountain regions of the central and the western China. Okay, whatever the central and the western China is there, this particular region is responsible for the creation of the many species, because many of our crop plants were actually got domesticated or got originated in that particular Chinese center. So which plants got originated in this Chinese center? See, the endemic species listed from the center includes the soybean. Okay, so soybean is a Chinese species, radish, turnip, okay, pear, peach, plum, calocasia, then the black wheat, then opium poppy, brinjal, apricots, then the oranges and the China tea. All these plants got originated at the Chinese center of origin. Okay. Now here we are using the word endemic. Endemic, that literally means the plant species are restricted to this region only and they were not found throughout the world. Okay. But later they may have got introduced throughout the world. But actually at the beginning, when there is origin of the crop plants, the all these species were endemic to this particular Chinese center of origin only. That is, all these plants which are mentioned here, they were only present in this part of the world and not rest of the part of the world. But today we find this plant in the rest of the world as well because of the introduction. Okay, we have collected these species from the Chinese center of origin and then humans have transported these particular plant species throughout the world. So the first center of origin which is given by the Vevilio is the center of origin of the crop plants, which is called as the Chinese center of origin. Okay, and all these plant species were originated at this particular Chinese center. The second was the Himalayan center. Okay, it is also called as the Indian center of origin. Okay, so we were talking about this part. Okay, now see, the Indian center of origin is there, which is also called as the Himalayan center. This center includes the region of the Assam, which is state of India, okay, Burma, Indochina and the Malayan archipelago. Okay, so all this portion which is located here on this particular mother earth, this plant is responsible for creation or the origin of the many plant species, and this particular center is called as the Himalayan center of origin or the Indian center of origin. Now let us consider which plant species are endemic here. See, the endemic species listed from these centers include the rice. Okay, the very famous example is rice from the Indian subcontinent, then the red gram, chickpea, then the cowpea, mung dal, then the brinjal, cucumber, sugarcane, okay, black pepper, moth bran, okay, then rice, bean, cotton, turmeric, indigo and the millets. Okay, all of these important crop plants were actually originated from the Indian subcontinent. Okay, from the regions of the Assam, Burma, Indochina, Malayan archipelago. Okay, all these parts were taken into the Himalayan center, which is also called as the Indian center of origin, and all these plants material is got originated in that particular area. Okay, so this is the second center, which is called as the Himalayan center or the Indian center of origin. Now let us consider the third one, which is called as the Mediterranean center of origin. Okay, this center includes the borders of the Mediterranean Sea. Okay, whatever the Mediterranean Sea borders are there, these are Mediterranean Sea borders constitute this Mediterranean center of origin. Okay, see, most of the cultivated vegetables actually have originated from this region. Okay, let us consider which one. See, the durum wheat, then the emmer wheat, then the oat, barley, lentils, peas, grass pea, broad beans, cabbage, asparagus and peppermint, etc. were created in this particular Mediterranean center of origin. So the third center, which is given by the Vevilio, it is called as the Mediterranean center of origin, and this particular Mediterranean center of origin is very famous for the origin of the vegetables. Okay, and all these plants are there which are originated at the Mediterranean center of origin. Okay, now see the fourth center, which is called as the Abyssinian center. Okay, now this will include the parts of the Ethiopia and some parts of the Somalia. Okay, some Somalia parts and some Ethiopia parts are there. Together they were constituting the Abyssinian center of origin for the crop plants. Now see, the endemic plant species listed from these centers include the wheat. Okay, that is, the wheat is originated, then the sorghum, bajra, safflower, castor, broad beans, okra and coffee. All these are plant material were actually there in the Abyssinian center of origin. So what is important, whenever you describe the Vevilio centers of origin in the UPSC mains examination, the examples, okay, as you know, you have to remember the 8 centers, and out of the 8 centers, for each center you have to give the specific example. For example, the coffee is may have got only got originated in the Abyssinian center of origin. Okay, so this example become important to be mentioned in the answer. Okay, so the fourth center of origin regarding the cultivated plants is the Abyssinian center of origin, which is called as the Ethiopian or the Somalian center of origin, and all these plants got originated there. Now let us consider the fifth one, which is called as the Central Asian center of origin. Now this center will include the northwest parts of the India. Okay, then the Afghanistan, Uzbekistan and the western China. Okay, all these areas were covered here are the Central Asian center for the origin of the cultivated plants, and this will include the northwest India, then the Afghanistan, then the Uzbekistan and the western China. Okay, now the endemic species which are listed from this region are called as the bread wheat, then the club wheat, sesam, linseed, then the muskmelon, then carrot, onion, garlic, apricot, grapes, hemp, and the cotton. Okay, so as you know, the very, very important crop plants were originated in this particular Central Asian center, and this Central Asian center will also include the Northwest India. Okay, so it becomes very, very important that you show the examiner that the whenever you mention the name of the center, that is Central Asian center, which part is actually covering this particular center. Okay, that you have to mention. And the second important thing, you have to give the very proper examples of the plants which have got originated in that particular Central Asian center. Okay, now the sixth one is the Asia Minor center. Now this center covers the east of the Asian region, which includes the Iran and the Turkmenistan. Okay, this is also called as the Asia Minor center, and in this particular Asia Minor center you will find there is a Iran and there is a Turkmenistan. Okay, now the India, the endemic species which are listed from this region are called as the wheat, then the rye, pomegranate, okay, almonds, fig, cherry, walnut, alfalfa, and the Persian clover. Okay, so the pomegranate is a very famous example which got originated in the Iran region of today's, okay, or the Turkmenistan region of today's. So here in the Asia Minor center, very, very specific fruits, for example, the pomegranate fruit, okay, cherry fruit, walnut fruit, all these are got originated, and hence this Asia Minor center is very, very important from the crop plants origin point of view. Okay, so that is why Wavilio has created this particular center, which is called as the Asia Minor center, where the which will cover the Iran and the Turkmenistan of the present day, where you will find the origin of the pomegranate, origin of the almonds, origin of the figs, etc. Okay, so again, very unique plant and the very unique center is there in which these plants are got domesticated or originated. Now the seventh center is the Central American center. Now we are in the American subcontinent. In the Central American center, there are the many plants which got originated from the crop plant point of view. Now this center includes the Mexico, then the Costa Rica, then the Guatemala, and then the Honduras region. Okay, all these regions together constitute the Central American center of origin for the cultivated plants. Now, which endemic species are listed from there? See, the maize, rajma, then the lima bean, melon, pumpkins, sweet potato, okay, arrowroot, then the chili, cotton, papaya, guava, and the avocado. All these plant species were reported from this Central American center of origin of the cultivated plant. So see the very specific example. For example, the papaya is the product of the American subcontinent. Now this papaya is found throughout the world, including the India. Okay, so but actually the origin of this crop plant is located in the American subcontinent. Okay, so for the guava and so for the avocado. Okay, so all these plant species were reported from the Central American center by the Wavilio. Now let us consider the eighth one, which is called as the South American center. Okay, now this center includes the Peruvian region, then the Iceland of the southern Chile, then the Brazil and the Paraguay region. Okay, all these regions were together constitute the South American centers. Okay, like this here, South American centers are there. Then the endemic species which are listed from this center are the potato, the sweet potato, lima beans, tomato, papaya, tobacco, okay, quinine, cassava, rubber, groundnut, cocoa, and the pineapple. Okay, so cocoa or the pineapple or the tobacco are the typical examples that these plants got originated in the South American subcontinent, and then they were spread throughout the world. Okay, so this is the eighth and the final center of origin of the cultivated plants, which is given by the Wavilio, which is called as the South American center of origin for the crop plants. Now there are certain limitations for the Wavilio's views. Okay, now Wavilio's theory, which he has given in the 1926, have some of the drawbacks. Now let us discuss which drawbacks are there for the Wavilio's centers of origin. Okay, now see, Wavilio's consider the origin with the greatest genetic diversity. Okay, greatest genetic diversity is there, and this is the greatest genetic diversity of a species as the center of origin of the species. Okay, we have seen that what he has selected, if there is a center and the much of the diversity is present around that center, then he consider this center as the center of origin for that particular plant species. Okay, but now today we know that many such species are known whose center of origin and the genetic diversity are different. For example, maize and tomato. If you trace the origin of the tomato or the origin of the maize, you will find their center of origin is different and center of diversity is different. Okay, so according to the Wavilio centers of origin, we can consider the center of diversity as the center of origin, but for the tomato and for the maize, the center of diversity and the center of origin is different. So this cannot be applied for the Wavilio's centers of origin, and hence it becomes a major drawback for the Wavilio. Okay, that is, these are Wavilio's were having the center of origin along with the diversity. Okay, but this is not true for the tomato and the maize plant. Okay, and that is why it becomes the major drawback for the Vevilio centers of origin. Now, centers of origin of the cultivated plants as per Vevilio are limited to the mountains and the small hills in the tropical and the subtropical region. Yes, we have seen that. Vevilio said that the mountains, the lower area of the mountains and the small hills in the tropical and the subtropical area are the main centers of the origin. But the recent evidence suggests that the plains are the centers of origin of many cultivated plants. Okay, whatever the plain area are there, these are plain area were also responsible for the origin of the many crop plants. So this second assumption, which is given by the Vevilio, it is also not suitable for the theory of the origin of the crop plants. What the Vevilio is saying, that the centers of origin were located around the hills or around the mountains, but the today we know that the plains were also have the centers of origin. Okay, so this is the second drawback relating with the origin of the crop plants theory, which is given by the Vevilio. Now today several crop plants are known whose centers of origin were different from the one suggested by the Vevilio. Okay, now whatever the latest research is there, today we are finding many new crop plant origin centers. Okay, the one which is given by the Vevilio are there, plus in addition to these centers, we have also find the many other centers. So this again become the drawback for the Vevilio centers of origin, that he has not covered all the centers of origin. Okay, now moreover, there is a more than one center of origin. See, this is also the problem relating with the center of origin of the crop plants theory, which is given by the Vevilio. He is saying that there is only the one center of origin for the one species, but center of origin of the one species is maybe more than one. Okay, today we know that through the today's knowledge, we can say that there is a wheat which is found in the American subcontinent, and there is a wheat which is found in the Indian subcontinent, and there is a wheat which is found in the Chinese center as well. Okay, so the many centers of origin are there for the crop plants, as against the Vevilio, which is suggesting only the one center of origin for the each crop. Now also the origin of the many plant species cannot be traced due to the lack of sufficient evidences. Okay, whatever the crop plants we are using today, we cannot trace the origin of the every plant, because the knowledge relating with this particular finding is very less, and actually we do not have any particular protocol how to trace the origin of the any cultivated plant. Okay, and that is why our knowledge is very limited in that regard. Okay, now consider the fourth drawback. See, the according to the Vevilio's primary center is marked by the high frequency of dominant alleles towards the center and the recessive allele towards the periphery. Now see, what the Vevilio has said, at the center you will find the strong dominant genes at the center. Okay, for example, just like this, you will find the strong dominant alleles in the center, but as you go to the periphery, you will find the recessive type of the genes. Okay, and this is how the center of origin is there. Okay, at the periphery you will find the recessive genes, but at the center you will find the dominant genes. Okay, but this view is not acceptable as per the latest knowledge. Now today we have the genome sequencing, and through this genome sequencing we have find out that such a thing is not there. Okay, there is no thing like the recessive genes are present at the periphery and the high frequency strong dominant alleles are present at the centers only. Okay, so this observation of the Vevilio also got disregarded due to the latest knowledge. So this is the fourth major drawback relating with the theory of the Vevilio's regarding the origin of a cultivated plants. Okay, so this is all about this topic. Okay, thank you very much for watching this video. Please like this video, share this video with your friends who are studying the botany, and if you haven't subscribed to the Botany Obsession channel yet, please subscribe to the Botany Obsession channel for UPSC examination. Again, thank you very much for giving your time. See you in the next video lecture. Thank you.